sisters, the Lord be with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard what he said and followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following him and said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and you will see." So they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they stayed with him that day. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, was one of the two who heard John and followed Jesus. He first found his brother Simon and told him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated Christ. Then he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You will be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of the Lord.
As you walk in to the main doors of the National Shrine Basilica of the Immaculate Conception in Washington, you're immediately confronted by this incredible mosaic that sits way up above the main altar. And it's of Jesus in judgment. I'm sure most of you have seen a picture of it at least, but it's a brilliant, brilliant mosaic. Some people describe it as scary. Others see it with great joy and great hope. Now, as you approach that mosaic and you get close to the altar and you turn around, you see above the main doors of the basilica a beautiful, beautiful bas-relief sculpture that's called the Call to Holiness. And in that sculpture, we see all these people, men and women, young and old, different races moving towards the center. And the center, of course, is Christ. A universal call to holiness. Something that we are all called to. But we need to be open to that call. We need to be listening for God's call in our life, open to what He's asking us to do, and willing to say yes. In our first reading today and in our gospel reading, we hear of people being called by God. In our first reading, Samuel. Samuel was a child, an only child, longed for by his mother. In the early part of this book, we hear of his mother in the temple praying constantly, even though she was elderly, to have a child. She was beyond the age of what women would normally have a child, but she wanted one so desperately. God fulfilled her will. Her request was filled in Samuel. What we do know about Samuel that we heard last week was Samuel was presented to the temple. The mother, after the child was weaned, brought Samuel to Eli, who we also hear about in this reading today, and leaves him there in his care. Says, "I promised," his mother said, "that if this child would be given to me, I would give this child back to God." And she fulfilled her promise also. She brought Samuel to be guided and brought up in the service of the church. Eli took care of this child. And we pick up this story today. At night, Samuel's laying there asleep, but he hears a voice. And he assumes that it belongs to Eli, that Eli in his elderly years is asking for some assistance. But it's not Eli that is calling. It's God himself. God is calling Samuel to great works, to be a prophet of sort to the nation. But the first thing that that Samuel is given to do upon God talking to him is to tell Eli that his family is cursed. We miss 9 verses of this book from the end of the call of Eli to the end, that last line of our first reading today. And in there is the passage of what Samuel is first called to do. Not an easy task, because this man who has taken care of him his entire life, he now has to go to on God's behalf and say, your house is cursed. Because Eli, my servant, you did not call your own family to task for living against the teachings of myself, God says. Not an easy thing for Eli to do, but Samuel does do it. He was called to a life of holiness. He was called to a life of service to God. In our gospel reading today, we hear an end to John the Baptist's ministry and the beginning of Jesus's. And we hear 2 of the followers of John are again given direction, this time through John the Baptist on God's behalf as a prophet. And he tells the 2, go follow him. Go follow Jesus. He's the one you want to now follow. So they do, at a distance. Imagine the scene. They're walking along, Jesus in front. Jesus can sense their presence, turns around, and asks what they want. Where are you going? Where do you stay? Well, come and you will see. Andrew, and it's assumed the other one is John, go and follow Jesus. They call him Rabbi, that initial encounter, and they spend the night with him. They learn from him. They listen to him speak. And the very next day, they now run back to their friends, their brothers, Andrew to Peter, and says, we found the Messiah. No longer rabbi, no longer a teacher, but the anointed one, the one who's been called and sent among us. These 2 apostles get their initial call from God through John the Baptist. They leave everything behind and follow God's call for them to holiness in their way, in what they have been given by God as their mission. Each and every one of us also gets this call from God in some way, shape, or form. We're all called to that holiness that sculpture and the basilica represents. But we need to be open to listening, just as Samuel was, just as Andrew and John were that day. What is God's call for us? St. Francis de Sales writes about this in a book, and he says, everybody's call is different, and you need to look for your call in your state of life. Because the call of a monk or a cloistered sister is different than a call of a husband and wife, which is different than a call of a child, which is different than a call of a priest or a deacon. Each of us live our life according to God's call for us, where he puts us in this world, our task that he has given to us as individuals. Are we opening to hearing God's call? Do we hear that little voice that Samuel heard? Probably not in the way he heard it, because he probably heard an actual voice speaking to him. We'll hear a voice in our heart saying, live this way. Here's what will make you happy. Here is your ministry in life. Are you willing to take up the task God asks? If you do, you'll become holy. If you follow my command and my request of you, you'll be along the path of holiness. Those who follow God's call those who follow the universal call to holiness, are not afraid to walk into that basilica and look at Christ in judgment, knowing that one day that exact thing will actually happen in our lives, because we know we've lived a life that God has called us to. And Christ in judgment, for us, will be nothing to be afraid of. Let us ask God each and every day, where do you want me? What can I do to be of service to you and your church today? What will help me become a holy person? All we have to do each morning is say, as Samuel did, "Here I am, Lord. Speak. Your servant is listening."